Now there's another part of our overall data compression scheme, and that is the compression test. And in this test, what we're trying to do is store on disk only those things that are meaningful and that will help us reproduce the trend. So now you might think, well, isn't everything meaningful? Let me give you an example. If you take a look at this illustration here, we've got with time on the bottom here and temperature over here. As values come into the system, we will archive certain of those values. Now, each time a value is presented to the snapshot, we don't automatically write that to the archive, because as you can see here, if we look at the overall trend, just this vector that we see is being made by this data, the overall vector of the data allows us to store just the first value and just the last value, more or less the peaks and the valleys of the data, and more or less reproduce the entire trend just with those two points. Now I say more or less because as you can see, there's a slight variation here, but it's a variation that the user decides whether that is something significant to him that he would actually archive each and every value. So it is up to you. This is something you can turn off entirely. If you want, you can archive each and every value by turning off what we call the compression test, in which case we'll store each and every value. But if you decide to go with compression, and most of our customers do, then what you'll see is, you'll see drawing straight lines, like you see this dotted line here, straight lines between the peaks and valleys, and then, continuing on to the next peak and valley. And what that does is it results in storing data that is accurate enough for almost all engineering purposes. Now, just as with the exception test, what controls the mechanism here of the compression test are some point attributes. The point attributes are going to be the compdev, that's the compression deviation, that can also be specified as a percent of span. So you might also use compdev percent instead of compdev. And there's also an attribute called compmax, that's the compression maximum time. And like the exception maximum, that basically indicates that when that much time goes by, we will go ahead and archive something, whether it's gone outside the dead bands or not. And here's a quick reminder that these are point attributes, the compdev and the compmax, etc. They're attributes of a point, like for example, this tag CDT158, it has all these different attributes, including the compression deviation and the compression maximum time. You can see this is the max and the min time here. Incidentally, that minimum time does exactly the opposite of the maximum time. That means that if you set this to, say, 5 minutes, then you will get no values stored more closely together than once every 5 minutes. Not a terribly in-demand feature, but it is an option for those people who need to throttle a tag that's storing too much data. Here's an illustration of how the compression test works. Now, each of the values that comes into the snapshot, we're going to apply that compression test to those values. So as these values come into the snapshot, we draw a dead band around those values. And the dead band is equivalent to the last archived value, which we see right here, plus or minus this compression deviation. So we'll take that last archive value, plus and minus that compression deviation. We'll take the current value, plus or minus the exception or the compression deviation, and we draw that dead band or this parallelogram. Now, as values come in, we're going to extend that parallelogram. And it simply works this way. If we have any values that fall outside the parallelogram, then we know we've got a value that is basically outside of that vector. Yeah, there we go. We have a value that's outside the parallelogram. So the vector has changed. And when that happens, what we archive is the previous value. So as you can see, that's the value marked A for archive. That's the value that we archive. That's what preserves the peaks and valleys. As you can see, we don't really know when we've hit a peak or valley until we've gone past it. So that's going to go ahead and extend that from the last archive value to the current value, or the most recent one that's been archived. And of course, at this point, the whole thing starts over again. We extend that parallelogram. Anything that falls outside indicates there's a value that needs to be archived. So in that case, that previous value is archived. And in this case, another value is archived. Now here we have a sequence in which nothing goes outside this parallelogram, so we don't archive anything until this value forces many of the values to go outside the parallelogram, and then we archive the previous value. And that continues on and on. Yeah, there we go. Still, this vector, the parallelogram defines the vector that we're looking for. As you can see, the bigger you make this compression deviation, the wider that parallelogram will be, and you'll store fewer values. Yeah, here we go. At this point, now we archive the previous value, and this is what we end up with in terms of archive data at the end of this compression test. Now, you may well wonder, why are we covering this in this class? This is a class on using the clients. Well, it's very important to know, as folks that depend on data, that when you have values in ProcessBook, for example, that are being trended, and you need to know exactly what happened at this point in time, what we're going to do is, if we drop a trend cursor on there in ProcessBook, we're simply going to interpolate a value between here and here. And what you know about that value, that interpolated value that you see right here, we know that the value could not have been greater than that interpolated value plus the deviation, the compression deviation, and that interpolated value minus the deviation. So, you know, we've actually had customers find themselves in court, and somebody asks them, well, what was the value at this point in time right here? Well, you don't want to answer by saying, well, I have no idea what it was. I know when it was here, and I know what it was here, but I have no idea. No, you simply do a linear interpolation, add and subtract the compression deviation, and that's the range of possible values. Now let's do one last recap and just take a look at what all this looks like from beginning to finish. Here's the raw data as it was scanned on the instrument system. And after the exception test, we eliminate some of those values. So as you can see, these values here were eliminated by the simple dead banding. And then, now that's not good enough because we still have the opportunity to remove more data to save space and make this data more responsive, more quick to appear on your systems by just gathering these peaks and valleys. And we do that through the compression test. And so this is what you see after the compression test. And again, if this is something you're not interested in, if you'd like to actually store every single value scanned, that's not a problem. Just set, or you can configure, the exception and compression deviations so that you will store all values.